Meet Warhurst on ABC Radio.
There are some folks who lived a life a little bit more extreme than the rest of us. Bruce Jackson was one such fella. He was Elvis's right-hand man. He was so respected, Elvis wouldn't go on stage if Bruce wasn't there working side of stage to tell him that things were going to be okay. Gary Jackson, Bruce's brother, has put together a book on his brother Bruce's life, inspired by a whole lot of letters that Bruce diligently wrote home, which documents his extraordinary career, not just working with Elvis, but working with the likes of Bruce Springsteen and Barbara Streisand. Hello, Gary.
Hello, Miff.
Great to talk to you. Was it true that Elvis hired Bruce for shows in Las Vegas when he wasn't even needed for those shows? He just wanted him there?
That's true. Bruce was contracted with Clare Brothers to do the touring sound only. The Las Vegas shows were all done with an in-house system. But with Bruce's many developments, which is hanging the speakers and improved sound all the time, the Las Vegas setup tended to lag behind. And it came to the point where Elvis did trust Bruce to the extent that he asked him to come to Vegas just to stand there and tell Elvis everything's okay.
Well, that's a pretty high honour for having Elvis to say everything's okay. What was their relationship like? He seemed to forge a close personal bond with someone who I imagine was pretty private by all accounts.
Yeah, he was a pretty private guy, but you've heard all those stories about Elvis's yes men and all. Everyone told Elvis what he wanted to hear. Well, Bruce, by his nature and by the fact that he was a young Australian guy, didn't respect that. Bruce was very straightforward. He'd say what he felt to Elvis, and if something wasn't going right, he'd say so. But the problem in the first year or so of touring was that there was a chain of communication. So if Bruce said, "I'd like to do something," Elvis wouldn't get to hear about it. And if Elvis complained about something with the sound, Bruce wouldn't hear it from Elvis. So one day Bruce had enough of all that and he quit. But the word went straight back to Elvis, and Bruce didn't get even as far as the front door when Elvis came out and apologized and said, Bruce, I'm sorry. I just had a bad night." And from that point, Bruce and Elvis developed a very close relationship, and that was the basis of mutual respect and the background to Elvis wanting Bruce there all the time.
What was it like, Gary, having a brother like Bruce, living this life, flying all over the world, touring and becoming very much the confidant of some huge celebrities in a time when, you know, it was pre-internet? These kind of experiences weren't at our fingertips. What was it like being the brother of someone like that?
Well, it was great because we bathed in his glory to the extent that whenever an act came to town, we'd get free tickets to it.
Fantastic.
And they're always premium tickets. He was very good. It came out in putting the book together that everyone loved Bruce Jackson, and it's because he was very giving. He looked after people. Apart from the free tickets, he would mentor many young sound engineers with their career. And so it was hard to find anybody, except maybe another sound engineer with some jealousy, who'd say a bad word about him.
Yeah. Bruce is no longer with us, Gary, which would be very sad for you. But putting together this document of Bruce's life and the history and going through, as I mentioned in the introduction, the letters that Bruce wrote home very diligently and quite detailed letters, what was that experience like for you?
Well, it was good for us. He'd write back to the family via our mother and also to his girlfriend Margaret. And fortunately, Margaret kept all the letters and they were a treasure trove when we found that she still had them, because it did document day to day what it was like on the road. Bruce also would come back from a tour and he'd sit in his apartment with a scotch and he'd recount on a tape what had happened over the past usually it's 2 weeks tour. So we really have a fantastic documented day to day history of what it was like. And having that stuff in hand really made it a no-brainer that we had to put this book together.
Absolutely. I actually have some audio here of your brother, Bruce, retelling a story of Elvis cracking it over the sound system that was in his private jet, the Lisa Marie. Now, if anyone's been to Graceland, you'll know that the Lisa Marie is still there in all its 70s interior glory. There's so much velour and chenille and all sorts of garish colours you can throw a stick at, and it's just magnificent. But there was a sound system that Bruce was responsible for, and this is the story he says about Elvis discussing the new sound system.
2 o'clock in the morning, the boss wants to see you. So I put my jeans on and T-shirt and go up, and there's Elvis sitting in bed with his karate jacket on, his gold-plated gun beside him. And he said, Bruce, the goddamn sound system on the goddamn plane's all up. I don't care what it costs, fix it, I'm going to shoot the goddamn thing out. And so from that point on, everyone was nervous because they knew that if he didn't like anyone on TV, he'd actually shoot him. And the consequences of shooting in a plane, obviously, are more dire than shooting the TV set. So until I put the new sound system in, everyone was a little nervous.
I think you would be nervous if you think Elvis was going to shoot up an aeroplane. That's amazing to have that story in your arsenal. Did he have many stories like that?
He had lots of stories. One was, I think it was 1976, and Elvis's girlfriend was Ginger Alden. Well, Bruce used to sit immediately to the right of the stage, mixing the stage monitors. And over the years, Elvis's current girlfriend would sit with Bruce. And at this stage, Linda had come in, and Linda was... Ginger. Linda had gone out and Ginger had come in. And after the show, Bruce got another call in the middle of the night. Come on up. The boss wants to see you. So he pulled his jeans on, went up there, and there was Elvis, same thing, by the bed. And he said, he didn't look very happy. He said, Bruce, I hear you've been messing with Ginger. I saw your hand on the knee during tonight's performance. And Bruce saw the gun and said, oh, no, Elvis, no, really, he denied it. And he went red, and Elvis let him suffer for a minute or two. And then he said, no, only kidding, Bruce. And then gave him a hug and he said, I just wanted to ask you about the sound.
So, Elvis was quite the joker, wasn't he?
He was. I think Bruce was lucky getting to know him at that level, because I don't think many people did, if anybody knew him at that level other than Bruce.
I'm with Gary Jackson, who's written a book about his brother's incredible life. Once Elvis's right-hand sound guy, here is Elvis Presley singing Happy Birthday to your brother, Bruce.
I'd like to take just a minute, ladies and gentlemen, one of my sound engineers. I have three of them here. I have a guy with the name of Bill Porter, who's a sound engineer, and Felton Jarvis, and a guy named Bruce Jackson. He's from Australia, and today's his birthday. I wish you a happy birthday, Bruce. And happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Bruce Goose. Happy birthday to you.
That'd be pretty special to have Elvis sing Happy Birthday to you. But as I said, Elvis, bit of a joker, Bruce Goose. They obviously had a good friendship and quite a sort of an amiable friendship where they joked around with one another, which is nice. Mm.
It wasn't without its professional problems. Elvis, because Bruce sat so close to Elvis on stage, anything to do with the sound, Elvis would come straight back to Bruce, especially feedback, which was a problem with having so many stage monitors. If Elvis took his microphone too close to a stage monitor, there'd be feedback. So Elvis used to get Bruce on that, and sometimes he did it for a joke. Sometimes if you saw Bruce looking away, not looking at him, he'd shove his microphone into a stage monitor, producing a squeal, and that would bring Bruce back to attention. Elvis would laugh.
Very harsh, very harsh. How does a fella from Sydney, your brother Bruce, end up working for one of the biggest stars in the world?
Well, the first tour he did with Elvis was in November 1971, and he was only 22. Bruce dropped out of university. He was studying electrical engineering. He dropped out because the dean said that he should pick another career, perhaps, more suited to his talents. But Bruce was actually way ahead of what was happening in university. He teamed up with a schoolmate, Phil Story, and Phil was famous for having a pirate radio station at Vaucluse Boys High School in Sydney when he was still at school. And Bruce and Phil teamed up. They formed a company called JANS, which stands for Jackson and Story, and JANS is still in business today. It's the biggest sound entertainment company in Australia. And Bruce was building stroboscopes, inventing psychedelic lighting equipment, building amplifiers, and he met up with Roger Foley, who was known as LSD Fog, and Bruce started building equipment for him. And JANS became a really successful business. Blood, Sweat and Tears were touring in 1970, and they were playing at Randwick Racecourse out in the open. And Bruce found his way through the horse stables, and after the show introduced himself to Roy Clare, who was doing the sound. They got on really well together, and Roy was impressed with Bruce, and also impressed with his looks. He said he was a handsome young blonde guy, and that doesn't hurt you in this business. And soon, Roy offered Bruce a job, based in Lititz in Pennsylvania, a small town, in Amish country.
Wow!
So Bruce went across, and he said, "Next thing I knew, I was working for Clare Brothers at 39 cents an hour." And
39 cents an hour.
Right, and Roy Clare was a sort of anything is possible sort of guy, and he sent Bruce straight out on Johnny Cash tours. On Jackson 5 tours, Michael Jackson, as a young kid in his pajamas, used to hang around with Bruce because he could get away from his father in Bruce's hotel room. And within 6 months of Bruce being there and touring with Glenn Campbell, a whole bunch of guys, the top names in the world at the top of their game, he went out on the Elvis tour, and everything worked. And he stayed with him until Elvis died.
That's a beautiful story. Mm. He was such good friends with Elvis. Elvis let him fly his planes. Mm. Is that true?
Well, that was when Elvis wanted Bruce to put the new sound system in the plane. He said, "Bruce, I've got the plane lined up out at the airport." It was in Las Vegas. And he said, "They're going to take you for a fly in the morning, and you can see what's wrong with the sound." So Bruce goes out to the airport in the morning, and there's the Boeing 707-sized aircraft waiting with all fueled up and ready to go. But he went on board, and he went to see the captain. The captain, who he knew, was furious. He said, "You know, this is going to cost us $1,600 just to fly around and tell you what you already know." So Bruce said, "Well, you know, Elvis did say he wanted to do it." But the captain was furious, and so Bruce backed off and said, "That's okay." But anyway, they flew the plane down to Miami to have the work done, and on the way Bruce flew the plane for half the trip sitting in the right-hand seat.
Wow.
And that sort of began Bruce's interest in flying, and
right.
He soon bought his own plane.
Yes, and we'll get to that. Just a quick question about Elvis, one of the final ones I've got for you. Did Bruce get a shout-out in the legendary, the very classic 68 comeback special? And if people aren't familiar with it, the image of Elvis in a full leather outfit in 1968, pants and jacket, and it was really the remaking of Elvis's career. Did your brother Bruce get a shout-out from his man Elvis in that documentary?
No, because that preceded Bruce's work, because that was 68, and that's when Elvis was back on the scene.
Ah.
And Bruce didn't work with Elvis until November 71.
Ah, right. Oh, well, good. I'm glad we've got that cleared up. I do love the comeback special. I wasn't sure if your brother was around at that time. But it is a beautiful story, and it's lovingly collated and chock-a-block with letters and posters and all sorts of memorabilia provided by your brother. Your brother's sadly no longer with us, and I'm sorry for that. Why did you want to make this book? Why do you think it was important for Australians to know your brother and his role in the work of many huge famous names?
Well, he did have a very extraordinary career, and he left a his hangar, where he kept his plane at Santa Monica Airport, was stacked to the ceiling with memorabilia, with records of that. And I felt that given that opportunity, because I'm in the graphics business and the writing business with my wife, Helen, I thought, what better use of our time to put this together? It should be done. It's better than any statue. It's better than any memorial. It exists as a record. And as time goes by and everybody, you know, tends to forget, there it is, you know, forever.
A special document, and if people are looking for it, the book is called On the Road with Elvis. It is out now. Bruce went on to work with another Bruce Springsteen. He, in fact, does the foreword in the book. Tell me about that relationship.
Well, Bruce had, a few months after Elvis had died, Bruce was going out with various groups, not really enjoying it. And then Springsteen was touring, and he wasn't a big name at the time. It was just a small name with the East Street Band. And Clare Brothers were supplying the sound engineer, who became sick on a tour. So they sent for someone, and Springsteen said to Roy Clare, "Who have you got?" And Roy Clare says, "Well, I've got Bruce Jackson. He did monitors for Elvis." And Springsteen, being a huge Elvis fan, said, "That's the man for me. Send him out." And Bruce did every Springsteen show for the next 10 years, and they became very close friends. In the 85 Born in the USA tour, Bruce brought Springsteen over to our mum's place for dinner.
What do you cook Bruce Springsteen for dinner? What did your mum cook Springsteen for dinner? I would be so consumed with anxiety about what would be the right thing to serve. What did she serve? Do you remember?
Well, I think it was a prawn cocktail.
Of course.
Probably in the 70s, 80s.
I hope and she I added a little bit of the cocktail sauce as
I
well.
Think so.
Thousand and Island dressing?
All of that. And I think it was fried chicken or roast chicken. And I think there was some sort of strawberry parfait for dessert.
That's a classic meal. And did Bruce love it? Did he finish his plate?
Well, it was funny. Bruce Jackson warned us, now, don't anybody say anything stupid when Springsteen's there. And actually, Springsteen sat up. He's kind of rigid at the table. And his conversation didn't loosen up for some time. There was a conversation about... between Bruce Jackson and Bruce Springsteen. It was a professional conversation on the music business. But he loosened up after a while, and it was obvious he's just a very normal, natural, funny guy.
Sounds like it. And he was mates with your brother, so that makes him a good fella as well. And it sounds like your brother forged a lot of great friendships and professional friendships in the music industry. Mm-hmm. Worked in all the venues, the Hollywood Bowl, worked with all the legends. It's a beautiful book that you've put together. It's called On the Road with Elvis. It's out now. And Gary Jackson, thank you so much for sharing the story about your brother Bruce.
Thanks, Biff. I enjoyed it.
It's a beautiful chat. I mentioned the 68 comeback special. Bruce didn't get a shout out on this one because it was a little bit before his time, but I thought the song was appropriate, If I Can Dream, from that special. A beautiful Elvis track, mostly because you can dream and you can be from Sydney and you can start from scratch and end up working with some of the biggest names in the business. And this is an incredible song here on ABC Radio.
There must be lights burning brighter.